Jai Hind, this is Brigadier Hemant Mahajan welcomes you to another session on various aspects of national security. The topic which we are going to talk today is narco-terrorism. While we as Indians are aware of many types of terrorism, such as terrorists carrying out bomb blasts, terrorists carrying out gun attacks like 26/11, etc., but narco-terrorism is not given due importance. And what I must state here in my opening comments is that narco-terrorism today is much more serious than even the terrorism that is known to us. Just to give you one example, Khalistani terrorism, which killed thousands of people, has got more victims because of narco-terrorism than because of Khalistani terrorism. Similarly, we are well aware of the insurgency that goes on in the Northeast. The number of people killed in the insurgency in the Northeast is much, much lesser than the narco addicts who die every year because of narcotics. So narco-terrorism is a very big threat as far as India's population is concerned, as far as India as a nation is concerned. I'll very briefly state that today our border states of Northeast, that is Mizoram, Manipur, etc., are highly affected because of narco-terrorism. Similarly, states having international border with Pakistan, especially Punjab, is a big victim of narco-terrorism. Not only that, a lot of drugs are also coming from the sea. There have been a lot of seizures on the Gujarat coast. Adani port had a very big seizure. And even in Mumbai, we had a very large number of seizures as far as narcotics is concerned. So today we will cover a large ground. What is the status of narco-terrorism today in the country? Narco-terrorism status today in Maharashtra? What are the security agencies doing about it? What do they need to do to make it sort of more successful in their anti-narcotics operations? And we as a citizen, what role we can play to ensure that narco-terrorism in the country is reduced? And to talk to me on this very important subject, we have today with us former DGP of Maharashtra Police, Shri Praveen Dikshit. Welcome, Praveen Dikshit ji. And I'll very briefly again reintroduce him to you. We had introduced him in the last session also, and people in Maharashtra, or for that matter, even in India, know him quite well. A former police DGP of Maharashtra Police, he's been very active thinker, writer, commentator on issues related to national security. And he has got a wide experience in dealing with subjects such as Naxalism, terrorism, and of course, narco-terrorism. So we would not have a better person to talk on this issue than Shri Praveen Dikshit. Welcome, Praveen Dikshit ji. And after my opening comments, I would request you to comment on the severity of narcotics terrorism in Maharashtra, what effect it has on youth today, and how exactly are the security agencies tackling it. Over to Shri Praveen Dikshit ji.
Thank you. As you are aware, since last 2 days and even today, the director generals of police of all the states and all the director generals of the central paramilitary forces and central agencies are having a conference. And in this conference being held at Lucknow, the two important topics are being highlighted. Number one is the narco-terrorism or narco-trafficking, and second is terrorism, among other issues. The other issues are cyber crimes, the issues pertaining to border security, issues pertaining to coastal security, etc. Now, that itself highlights the importance of these two subjects, that is narcotism, narcotic trafficking, and the relation or the nexus between narcotics and terrorism. Now, before we proceed to this, we need to appreciate that there is a concept called golden triangle and golden crescent. The golden triangle is Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Iran, and it borders with India. On the other hand, golden crescent is where the Myanmar, Thailand, and Laos, again bordering with India on the other side of the coast. Now, these two are the golden triangle as well as golden crescent are the areas where the maximum production of narcotics takes place. Now, you will appreciate among these countries, the most of these states are known as the failed states in the international arena. So what is a failed state? A failed state is where there is no much economic progress. The people are quite poor. They are hardly able to sustain themselves. The governments themselves are not in a position to support the aspirations of these people. And as a result, what these people are doing is, at minimum cost, they cultivate the narcotics or the banned drug, psychophagic drugs in these areas. And the investment required for such cultivation is, you can say, almost nil. The cost of, say, cocaine, which is produced if in the country of origin, if it is 100 rupees, the international price for it is more than 1 lakh rupees. So you can imagine the amount of profit which is involved in the whole thing. And for last several decades, we are seeing this from Golden Triangle as well as Golden Crescent. Initially, it was India was being used as a country of transition. That means the drugs were pushed in, and from India, these drugs were being moved to either Europe, UK, Australia, or North America, including United States, Canada, and other places. Okay.
Yeah. Thanks a lot for your initially introductory comments. I would like to highlight it for our viewers that I collected some data from Narcotics Control Board, and it says in last six to eight months of this year, that is year 2020, the security agencies have seized 3,040 kilograms of heroin, 430,264 kgs of poppy, 335,052 kgs of ganja, and 215 kgs of other narcotics. So simply in terms of volumes, it's a very huge volume. And what we always understand is, while the seizures have been increasing over the period of time, but the fact also remains a lot of narcotics escapes the dragnet of the security forces. And secondly, what has been highlighted in the Narcotics Control Bureaus is that this the narcotics is arriving in our country from the land borders, from the sea borders, and also from the air. There have been a lot of seizures which have been done at the international airports, etc. So now what I would want you to talk about is, as far as the state of Maharashtra is concerned, we have a longish, we have a coastline of about nearly 760-770 kilometers, and we are quite near from one of the golden triangles of Afghanistan, Iran, and all. And recently there has been a seizure of nearly 3,000 kgs of narcotics in the Adani port, which came in a container. And also in the Nhava Sheva port, also there have been seizures. So please educate us on this issue of how narcotics comes inside Maharashtra from the sea borders as well as from the air. Over to you, Pravinji.
Now, in addition to the narcotics coming from outside, see, we are also, there are certain states in India itself, including Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, where the land is highly cultivable. It's an excellent land. And from where, again, this ganja particularly is coming in a huge amount. It is coming by roads, it is coming by train, and other areas also. So these are the two main sources from where the narcotics is being pushed in. Now, where does it go? As I said initially, see, the first people were of the impression that it is going outside. It is being exported, or it is India is being used as a transit. But over the last few decades, the consumption of narcotics in India as well as in Maharashtra has gone phenomenally high. As you are already mentioning, see, the areas like Punjab, areas like the approximate to Delhi, areas which are approximate to northeast, they are already notorious for being victims of narcotics. Now, however, a situation has come where most of the central institutes or institutes where the highly talented youth are reaching after competitive services, competitive examinations, or institutes of higher learning, the colleges, universities, and now even the schools, nearby the schools, this cocaine or the narcotics contents are available in plenty. And the idea, as you mentioned briefly in the beginning, it is worse than terrorism because this is killing the truth, killing the youth and the talented youth of India from within. And this is precisely what our enemy countries, including Pakistan, China, and now Afghanistan, are striving at. They are aiming to kill our own youth, talented youth, by their own consumption. And that is the worst situation. So now we cannot say that it is only Punjab or a few states in Northeast which were the victims. Now the narcotics has reached even in the interior parts of the entire states, including Maharashtra, and particularly the youth. And the reasons for that, we will discuss it separately.
Thanks a lot. You talked about the failed states such as Afghanistan, Pakistan, etc., who use narcotics terrorism for boosting their revenues. In fact, it is said that the biggest source of income as far as Afghanistan Taliban government is concerned is narcotics. And that is the reason why such a huge seizure was made at the Adani port, because these had come from the Helmand province of Afghanistan. And this problem is going to continue because Taliban ruled Afghanistan shows no signs of stabilizing. And similarly, when you look at failed states, there are failed individuals. The narcotics bureaus, one analysis was put on the net, which talked about who are drug addicts. You know, the drug addicts are the ones who don't do well in life. Drug addicts are the ones who sometimes are criminal. Drug addicts are the ones who have personal problems. There are n number of reasons that were attributed to why youth or people who take become drug addicts, the reasons for it. They are being listed, and of course some more may be also be found out if you do more deeper research. But what is today scary is, in addition to the failed youth, failed people, criminals, there are people from the middle class, people from the higher middle class, people from the lower middle class, people who have done reasonably well in life. They are also falling to drug terrorism because of many reasons, which are a lot of times the reasons are psychological in nature. So I would request you now to throw some light on who are the typical drug addicts. That is one issue. And what is the modus operandi of these drugs finally reaching the drug addicts? And of course, the last point is, how do you stop this? Praveen ji.
Now, see, as you mentioned, in fact, the youth, particularly the youth who are in the information technology, IT industry, or the youth who are students of management, the students who are studying in IITs. Now, because of the high expectations given from these students, my suggestion to all our faculty in these best universities is they should reduce the workload given to the students in these places. In fact, most of them, they expect that the students who are joining these places will be working for 24 hours. If not for 24 hours, at least for 19 to 20 hours. Now, the normal capacity of a student is not to work for 19 to 20 hours every day. And because of the very high expectations, and since they are not able to cope up with it, to overcome this particular syndrome, most of them, they start consuming the drugs. And thus, that leads to their addiction. More than that, we have to also appreciate the failure of having any dialogue in the families between the parents and the students. As most of the parents, including the father, mother, both are working and they are having their career in mind, most of the time they are outside the house. So that leaves the children totally secluded, totally in a alone, in lonely conditions. And overcome these particular feeling of loneliness or frustration among the youth, if they are driven to drugs, there is no surprise. In fact, I had an occasion to interrogate many such young students who were victims of drugs. And the reason which comes out is basically the failure of dialogue within the family. In fact, see, the unfortunate part of the drugs is that the discovery of a person having been addicted or has become an addict is only when the situation has gone out of control. When the parents were told that your students or your children are drug addicts, they were shocked. They said, no, this is just not possible. We have given him such a wonderful atmosphere in the house. We have given him all the facilities. We have given him all the gadgets. And this is just not this is just not possible. And you are wrong. But when they are confronted with the children themselves, and when the children themselves admit that, yes, they are drug addicts, the parents are shocked. And this is a situation, not I'm talking about North America or Europe or other countries, which are advanced countries, in so-called advanced countries in the world, but a similar situation has come in India as well. In fact, there have been instances where the grandparents who obstructed or who objected to the consumption of drugs by the young kids, by students of 11th, 12th class, etc., they even resorted to the worst situation and murdered the grandparents, grandfather, grandmother, etc. But they could not withdraw themselves from the addiction. So that is the type of addiction which is pervading, particularly the metropolitan cities and other areas.
You have very well covered as to why people become drug addicts and possibly what can we do to stop it somehow. There's one more issue that I want to put up forward is basically the pressure from the social peers. There is a lot of pressure on the youth. I remember during our younger days, if you did not smoke or if you did not drink, it was considered that you are not manly enough, and people used to put pressure. My God, you are studying in college, you have gone to so-and-so place, and you still haven't tasted liquor or you still haven't smoked. So similarly, these days in the society, a party, when it takes place, it must have drugs, it must have a bit of pornography. I don't want to get into very gory details of as to how these parties take place. But the fact is, there's a fair amount of social pressure on everybody that if you are staying in a high-class society, you have achieved some kind of a success in life, then you must take on to drugs, etc. So that is one issue. Maybe many well-known celebrities have fallen prey to the drugs. That is one issue that I would want you to highlight once again. And secondly, we as a society, what do we sort of do to stop this drug addiction? Firstly, drug addiction is best stopped, as you rightly said, at the level of parents, at the level of relations, then maybe at the level of NGOs, then maybe at the level of society, and maybe at the level of government level and security agency. So please cover these two issues as to how this drug addicts can be, you can take them out from this path of destruction and take them to drug addicts removal centers, etc., and removing the society pressure and using the other elements of society to tackle this the problem of narco-terrorism. Praveen ji.
See, there was a very interesting observation which recently was circulated in the social media, mentioning that the drug-producing countries are mostly in the, as we discussed in the Golden Triangle, where the punishment for drugs, even possession, etc., is death. However, the targeted countries are all on the periphery, which are not in the Gulf side. and that's how the Gulf has that's how the drugs are being pushed to the other countries. Now, how to tackle it? So there are two views on this particular area. Now, some of the advanced countries or countries including Portugal, Italy, Spain, in Europe, and US, Canada, they are now saying that banning the drugs is beyond their control. Because it may be Venezuela, which may be, or Mexico, which may be exporting drugs to countries like US or Canada, or Africa producing and exporting countries like Nigeria. Now, the countries are increasingly coming to the view that instead of banning the drugs, it is better we reduce the consumption by giving counseling to the addicts. Because if you totally withdraw the drugs, there is something called a drug withdrawal syndrome, which makes these people violent. And they may go to any extent because the symptoms are such that they cannot control themselves. Even if you keep them in jail, they will become violent there as well. So they say that counseling them and reducing the doses is perhaps the right approach to tackle the drug issue. In India, however, we are still of the lesser, I would say, situation where perhaps if the pressure from the family, perhaps the pressure from the friends is such that we can certainly have a dialogue with our youth. In fact, we should highlight these issues even in the schools and colleges and have regular, say, inspection of the surrounding places and have a checks done of the so-called dhabas, the tea shops, the restaurants, the persons who are selling cigarettes and all that. Because even through cigarettes, these drugs are being pushed in. Even in the pan that you may be eating, the drugs are being supplied. So these are the areas which we should make a very determined effort to see that the youth are protected from consuming the drugs either by chance or by accident, and certainly not at all by their choice.
Yes, I would want you to now take on two issues. One is there are a large number of security agencies which are involved in stopping this drug terrorism. You have the Director of Revenue Intelligence, then you have the Customs, then you have the Narcotics Control Board, then you have the State Police, and if you go to the coastal areas, then you have the various coastal security agencies like Navy and Coast Guard and police, etc. Now, there are always comments which appear in the media that the coordination between these agencies at times is not as much as is desired. And that is one issue. If there's a jointmanship, if there's a spirit of one, you know, cooperating with each other, the level of efficiency of stopping these drugs, be at ports, be at airports, be at land borders, will improve. So what else can we do? Because it is not to say that they are not cooperating with each other. But the only point that we need to highlight is how can we cooperate more so that the results produced are outstanding. Shri Praveen ji.
You see, as far as the agencies are concerned, so there are two, three aspects to it. One is that the agency which is supplying the information, it may be an international agency, it may be the national agency, they are always suspicious about the other side. Whether the information which is being provided to the person who is going to take action, whether he will act with integrity, or whether the person would himself be hand in glove with the addicts and may leak the information. And that is the most important reason why even the international agencies are always doubtful. In fact, there have been several examples from developing countries where the so-called chief of the Narcotics Control Bureau themselves were arrested because of their involvement with the drug lords. Because the money involved is phenomenal. The amount of money which comes in the drugs is unimaginable. And that's why this suspicion always lingers in the minds of those who are providing the information. Having said this, the intelligence is the only way you can tackle this issue. Because how and when these drugs have started from a place like, say, Afghanistan, if we have to know it in the Mumbai, either seaport or airport or land, as we had the Atari earlier. Now, to know and have this, because this kind of chance detection is very difficult. I mean, you may do it, but if it is a precise information, then the action can be pinpointed. And that's how we have to actually have better coordination among the international agencies, the national agencies, and the local agencies. All of them, they have to work hand in hand and tackle this issue. And to support them, the activities of well-minded NGOs, as well as the civil society, parents, all of them, have to join hands to tackle this issue. It is not simply that one against other, or you cannot work in isolation when you are tackling the issue of drugs.
You have rightly highlighted the role of intelligence agencies, because security forces will always fall short as far as guarding the borders are concerned. 16,600 kilometers of land borders, 7,600 kilometers of sea borders, and of course, air borders are limitless. So there will always be a shortage of security forces. And intelligence will always be a first line of defense. So maybe intelligence right at the source of origin, meaning in Afghanistan, in Myanmar, etc., where people can tell us that a consignment has started from Afghanistan, which via Chabar port is going to come to you. Maybe our intelligence in Iran, maybe our intelligence agencies right at the coast, right at...
In fact, I would go a step ahead.
And of course, intelligence agencies... Yeah. Intelligence agencies also inside the city. That possibly, this will definitely help. I would want you to just comment on now two issues. Another 4-5 minutes, we must stop this discussion. One is can we use the technology? Are the foreign countries, especially the advanced countries like USA, Russia, etc., are they using anything called technology to stop this menace of drug terrorism? That is one issue one would like to talk. And of course, your final comments on what shape will narco-terrorism take in the days to come, maybe this year, maybe in next 2 to 3 years. Ravindji.
See, narcotics per se itself is a dangerous thing, because as we discussed, it destroys the complete youth, it destroys their talent, and it makes them totally unable to apply their mind properly. But more, see, the worst part of it is the amount of phenomenal, as I said, profits which are emerging from the narcotics trafficking. They are being used for purchase or pushing weapons, and they are also being used for terrorism or conducting the terrorist activities. As the National Intelligence Agency, National Investigation Agency, NIA, has repeatedly proved in their charge sheet in some of the famous cases, particularly from Jammu Kashmir, from Punjab, where the direct nexus between narcotics and terrorism, or narcotics and weapons smuggling, has been established. And that is the real cause for concern. And therefore, the use of technology is very vital. We have to use all sort of technology, all sorts of technology, to detect and identify the drugs which may be pushed either through containers, or maybe sent by drones, or they may be coming by sea routes. Now, you will realize in South, for example, some of the Pakistani fellows who were being indulging in drug pushing, drug peddlers, they were arrested by Sri Lanka, and they were in the Sri Lankan jail. Now, it has been established that from Sri Lankan jail, they were still conducting these operations. And recently, huge consignments of drugs were seized on the borders of Kerala and Tamil Nadu. And they were coming from Afghanistan, Pakistan, but being pushed in by the persons who were in jail in Sri Lanka. And there are multiple terrorist organizations which are being floated, supported, aided, abetted by Pakistan with the entire intention of pushing the drugs in India. And it is huge. And it is not only limited to Pakistan. It is also believed that China is also hand in glove. And particularly from the Northeast, the Northeastern states are victims of drugs for last several decades. So that is the situation which creates tremendous alarm for everyone in the country.
Thanks a lot. We have covered a lot of aspects of drug terrorism. And in the end, all that we can say is to fight this menace of a big villain called drug terrorism or narco-terrorism, we require to cooperate with international agencies. We need to have our intelligence in places like Sri Lanka, Afghanistan, etc., Iran, etc. We need to guard our sea borders. We need to guard our land borders properly. We also need to carry out anti-narcotics operations. When the drugs reach cities, we need to keep on studying the modus operandi of the drug peddlers. We need to educate our youth. We need to take help of their parents, the relations, the society, the NGOs, and of course, at the end, all the government security agencies must work together. Only when this happens will we be able to tackle this.
My last suggestion, I would like to make one small suggestion.
Yeah, please do. Go ahead, please.
You see, we are having National Drugs Control Authority, that is the NCB, National Control Bureau, Narcotics Control Bureau at the national level. However, in the states, this job has been left to one or two functionaries which are not pinpointed or which are not directly responsible for it. My suggestion is that not only the government of Maharashtra, but the other states also, including the Gujarat, Punjab, and other states which are worst affected, they also must create a state narcotics control bureau. And that will become a focused area, and they can coordinate with the national authorities and ensure better implementation of the measures against control of narcotics. So that is an area where, which is still in the dark, and we should write to the government of India as well as the state authorities to implement this idea on priority.
That was a very good and practically implementable idea, that each state, especially the ones which are affected by narcotics, the border state, including Maharashtra, etc., must have their own narcotics control bureau so that they're able to focus on this issue in a better manner and coordinate all the activities of all the security agencies in a much better manner. Thanks a lot for your practical suggestions, and all that remains for me now is to once again thank you for a very useful and interesting discussion on one very important aspect of narco-terrorism. Let us hope that we as a country fight united to stop this menace once and for all. Thank you very much, and see you again next Sunday at the same time. Thanks a lot, and Jai Hind.
Jai Hind.
Sir, there are questions. Sir, there are some questions. Can we take that questions?
Achha, ispe dalo. Is it there? On the chat, can you put on the chat? Is Praveen Dixit ji there?
Yes, yes, I'm there.
Okay. Can you put in the chat? Yeah, mere ispe bejo, WhatsApp pe bejo. Pramod, so just copy it and send it to me on the WhatsApp.
Sir, kindly check WhatsApp, this Zoom chat.
Acha dala, okay. Acha, okay. First question asked by somebody is, what is S-400? S-400 is actually an anti-aircraft defense system. It is not related to today's topic. So we will talk about it some other time. It is not related to narco-terrorism. It's an anti-aircraft defense system which we are buying from Russia. Okay, next question. Anything else? Till the time Pramod is able to copy and put it there in the chat box, all that I would recommend to everybody is let all of us apply our brain power together and give out some positive recommendations which can help us to resolve all those various national security challenges that we face in the country. Because all of us have adequate brains, and if we think positively, we can definitely contribute to making this country more secure. There's another question which is put up here, which says, why government ask agencies to take help of collegiate? I'm not understood. What possibly is meaning is, can government take help from colleges? If that be the question, because otherwise the question is not clear. Question simply asked, why government ask agencies to take help of collegiate? I take it what you want to say is that there may be bright college students, there may be bright college professors. Since the issue affects colleges, why can't we take some recommendations from the college authorities, college management, college professors
In fact, we should take help of the religious leaders also. Religious leaders play a very crucial role in reaching the minds of the people.
Yeah.
So through the religious leaders, the message can go that how the drugs are really bad and how and what needs to be done to protect from them. Yeah, that is important.
Like Pravin ji said, we can take help from the religious leaders because they have a fair amount of influence over the society. And as the questioner person who questioned asked, the colleges. So maybe like Pravin ji had said, there are problems in the IT industry, there are problems with the high achievers. So whichever institutions this drug terrorism has infiltrated into, from them as to how we can tell this Minans in a better manner. It's a good suggestion. We appreciate it. Any other question, Pramod? प्रमोद कोई
नो सर दैट्स
अभी और आ रहे हैं उसको सिर्फ कॉपी करके इस पे डालो ना
अभी और तो कोई क्वेश्चंस नहीं है सर लेट मी चेक
ओके या चलो बाकी मैं देख रहा हूँ ये पेज के ऊपर काफी सारे लोगों ने जय हिंद बोला है काफी सारों ने वंदे मातरम बोला है काफी सारों ने थैंक यू बोला है काफी सारों ने बोला है कि गुड रिकमेंडेशंस एक्सेट्रा तो मैं इनसे इतनी ही रिक्वेस्ट अच्छा लगा होगा तो ज्यादा से ज्यादा लोगों का इसे शेयर करिए क्योंकि स्वतंत्र वीर सावरकर ये जो लाइव हम कर रहे हैं इसका उद्देश्य एक ही है टू इन्वॉल्व कॉमन सिटीजंस इन मेकिंग दिस कंट्री मोर सिक्योर तो प्रमोद मेरे ख्याल से अभी हम रुक शायद अभी और कोई क्वेश्चन नहीं है तो हम रोकते हैं एंड लेट अस एंड दिस सेशन हियर इटसेल्फ थैंक यू प्रवीण जी वंस अगेन एंड थैंक्स ऑल ऑफ यू फॉर अटेंडिंग दिस सेशन थैंक्स
थैंक यू वेरी मच थैंक यू
यस थैंक यू